Hey everyone, today I'm going to give you a brief overview of methamphetamine pharmacodynamics and a few of the evidence-based treatments for caring for persons with methamphetamine use disorders. And this information, this brief talk, will be to supplement this week's module, which includes the assigned readings from the textbook, the learning videos I've posted, and the additional materials I've posted. So, interestingly, the mechanism of action of methamphetamine, unlike most other drugs, is it hits two of the regulating mechanisms in our brain that maintains the optimal dose of neurotransmitter. So when a behavior requires the assistance of the biochemistry of a neurotransmitter, there's got to be a mechanism that makes sure that enough of the neurotransmitter signals other neurons. Not too much, not too little, but just to get the job done. And there's two ways the system regulates how much neurotransmitter stays in synapse for a certain amount of time. One, you know already, is called reuptake. And the sending neuron that wants to signal other neurons takes back up most of the neurotransmitters it just released into synapse. It's very conservative. And so that clears excess neurotransmitters out of the synapse. The other way is an enzyme in our brains and bodies called MAO, and that means monoamine oxidase. And you remember this one too. MA is monoamine. Those are neurotransmitters made from one, not the same, but one amino acid, hence monoamine. And the monoamines, the monoamine neurotransmitters, include serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine. Those are all monoamines. And we have an enzyme inside the neuron and throughout the synapses called monoamine oxidase, or MAO. And that's an enzyme that clears excess neurotransmitters, in this case monoamines, out of the synapse. It's just another way the brain and nervous system regulates the neurotransmitter levels and subsequently the activation of other neurons. Well, back to methamphetamine's mechanism of action. Methamphetamine blocks reuptake and inhibits MAO. So it essentially knocks out two of the primary governing mechanisms in our nervous system that regulates neurotransmitter levels. And particularly in dopamine, if reuptake is blocked and MAOs are inhibited, more dopamine will stay in the synapse for longer periods of time, activating other neurons over and over again. So this hyperstimulates dopamine neurons for the duration of methamphetamine's effects. Meth causes also an increase in the manufacturing or biosynthesis of new neurotransmitters by converting tyrosine amino acid into dopamine. Stores the dopamine that just recently been made into synaptic vesicles or vesicles and sends them down the neuron's axons and places the dopamine inside the synapse. The problem is that methamphetamine demands the brain make and release more dopamine than the brain has ever been built to keep up with. And so ultimately, it causes a significant decrease in the behavioral toxic effects of drug-induced low dopamine, and that is with repeated methamphetamine use. And this little illustration shows you the dynamics of synapse. Here's the sending neuron. Here's the receiving neuron. And here's the synaptic vesicles full of, let's say, dopamine, but it could be any of the monoamines. And you notice that the monoamine neurons, and in particular dopamine neurons, are central to the sensation of natural pleasures. Behaviors that need to be reinforced, such as eating, are deemed pleasurable by the person. And that's largely because of dopamine availability. But it's also the addictive properties of drugs of abuse, dopamine. The effects of amphetamine and cocaine, for an example, depend on the ability to increase dopamine in the synapse by the effects of methamphetamine on transporter dopamine. Sometimes they call it DAT, dopamine transporter or reuptake, and the vesicles, the synaptic vesicles full of neurotransmitters, for monoamine storage. And they call that VMAT2. Those are the vesicles that store monoamines. So why does methamphetamine have such an intense abuse potential? Well, look at this chart here. Methamphetamine triggers a sudden surge of dopamine. And the neurotransmitter, dopamine, is really responsible for the sensation of pleasure in the brain. And dopamine is released in response to certain natural behaviors, such as eating. Nicotine, alcohol, and other drugs release dopamine as well and produce an unnatural level of dopamine. But methamphetamine is absolutely the most intense dopamine agonist we know of. And this chart by Richard Rawson from UCLA shows comparatively the dopamine increase capacity of cocaine, nicotine, alcohol, and food, because food, eating, is pleasurable, and contrasts it with the dopamine output produced by methamphetamine. And if it just produced intense pleasure and that was it, okay. But it doesn't. It requires the brain to make and release more dopamine than it can keep up with, ultimately causing a dopamine deficiency syndrome characterized by symptoms of depression, anxiety, anhedonia, or the inability to experience any pleasure, hyperphagia, or eating anything that's not nailed down, and movement disorders such as constant tremors and little motor tics. So sometimes people ask me, well, what's the difference between cocaine and methamphetamine? Both are psychostimulants. Well, the pharmacokinetics tells us something about those differences. First of all, cocaine comes from a plant, the coca plant. Methamphetamine is completely synthetic. I suppose there may be a very distant relationship to the ephedra plant, where ephedrine comes into play, but methamphetamine really has no direct botanical basis. The route of administration for both drugs are the same. The pharmacokinetics of cocaine is that it's a very short-acting drug. When snorted, it's about 20 minutes or so. Inhaled or smoked, like crack, it's about a couple of minutes. Whereas methamphetamine is a long-acting drug because of the mechanisms of action we talked about previously, 8 to 24 hours. Interestingly, in cocaine, half of the drug is removed from the body in about an hour. And it uses CYP3A4 pathway. And remember, every time you see CYP in front of some numbers in this context of pharmacokinetics, it's referring to the liver P450 enzyme system. And CYP3A4, the primary liver enzyme that metabolizes cocaine, is the particular group of the P450 that cocaine uses. Whereas methamphetamine uses a completely different P450 system. It uses CYP2D6, completely different. Cocaine blocks reuptake of dopamine and serotonin and alters mu opioid receptors. And we have opioid receptors in our endorphin system. So it's a little peculiar that a psychostimulant, cocaine, interacts with our endorphin system. More about that when we talk about opioids in a couple of weeks. Whereas methamphetamine does the same blockade, reuptake blockade of dopamine and serotonin, but also blocks reuptake of norepinephrine. Unlike cocaine, methamphetamine, as we've said previously, inhibits MAO, resulting in more dopamine in the synapse for longer periods of time, stimulating receiving neurons over and over again. There's not really any neurotoxicity of cocaine unless it's been adulterated with something like Drano. But there is neurotoxicity of repeated use of methamphetamine, resulting in dopamine D2 receptor derangement in the frontal cortex of the brain. Symptoms to complication, for what this chart shows you, is that common symptoms from methamphetamine use. And with continued use, the symptoms can progress into complications. And they're all based upon drug-induced excess of these neurotransmitters, dopamine, DA, and norepinephrine, NE. And so these symptoms, which are very typical for acute methamphetamine intoxication. If repeat use is in order, then those symptoms can progress into complications. And just a note to counselors and clinicians, the central diagnostic feature of substance use disorder, which includes methamphetamine use disorder, is continued compulsive use despite negative consequences caused by and or exacerbated by the drug. So long-term effects, chronic use of meth is associated with intense cravings and withdrawal syndromes, sometimes in excess of a year. Neurotransmitter depletion specific to dopamine, tremor and motor tics, movement issues, paranoia and hallucinosis, weight loss, malnutrition, poor dental hygiene, and teeth and gum disease. And then there's a post-acute withdrawal syndrome. We used to call that the protracted abstinence syndrome, but it's now called the post-acute withdrawal syndrome that can last for months, perhaps years, with symptoms typically of depression, sleep issues, cravings, and anxiety. So Dr. Walter Ling, the professor emeritus and founding director, actually, of the integrated substance use programs at the UCLA David Geffen School of Medicine, gave us a working definition of treatment, and it's perfect. Treatment has to consider that becoming addicted is not the same as staying addicted, and that getting off drugs is not the same as staying off drugs. And the problem of addiction is not getting off drugs, it's staying off drugs. And staying off drugs, aka relapse prevention, requires replacing drug memories with non-drug memories. And the recovering brain will build new memories and experiences of a healthy, responsible, and meaningful life free of the need for continued compulsive drug use. And finally, there are evidence-based treatments specific for methamphetamine addiction. These three are the big ones. There's a couple more, but these are the top ones. They compare these to no treatment at all, generic drug counseling, and placebo. And these are superior in sustained recovery outcomes. They include motivational enhancement therapy, MET, cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, and motivational incentives for enhancing drug abuse recovery. Incentivization. We used to call that contingency management, but it's very similar. And then there's treatment, medication-assisted treatment. Specifically, there's no FDA-approved meds to stay off stimulants. There's some medicines used off-label with modest effectiveness, if any, and they include bupropion, which is Wellbutrin, naltrexone, methylphenidate, which is Ritalin, Modafinil, and buprenorphine. Interestingly, from the New England Journal of Medicine last month, or January of this year, there was a promising new treatment for methamphetamine use disorder, and it was a unique combination of naltrexone and bupropion. And the results in that study, good study, there was a response rate about six times greater than with placebo or in patients with moderate or severe methamphetamine use disorder. That means that they were able to obtain and sustain recovery, the cessation of continued compulsive use with this combination of medication-assisted treatment. But it's still in research. We've been looking for years to find a good anti-craving medication for methamphetamine. This just might be it. And the final thing I want to leave you with is this manuscript put out by SAMHSA, S-A-M-H-S-A, the Substance Use, Abuse, and Mental Health Services Administration. It's called Evidence-Based Resource Guide, Treatment of Stimulant Use Disorders, June of 2020. And it's a great guide that really helps healthcare providers and communities that want to treat stimulant use disorders. And it gives us relevant research findings, best practice standards of care, and offers a bunch of useful resources. And you can get this free, your own PDF copy, by going to the website listed below, www.samhsa.gov/publications. Okay, that's all I wanted to share with you right now, and I'll see you in a bit.